Hi, welcome back. Welcome to Insect Systematics lecture series. We'll continue our discussion on the general characters of orders and economically important families. So, since previous class, we were discussing the order level characters and important families of subdivision Polyneoptera. We completed the discussion on the Orthoptera and its economically important families in the lecture number 7. So that means we left with remaining Polyneoptera orders. So among these Polyneoptera orders, most of them are minor. Minor in the sense, only fewer species have been described and they are not economically important. They are not economically important in terms of agriculture, medicine, and veterinary sciences. But except now Blatodea, all the remaining orders are minor. So with the incorporation of termites under the order Blatodea, Blatodea has got now considerable economic importance. So hence, I am keeping the discussion on Blatodea for the next class. So for now, under the lecture number 8, so we will be discussing on the now Phasmatodea, Mantodea, Notoptera, Dermoptera, Plecoptera, Embioptera, and Zoroptera under the title Minor Polyneopteran Orders. So this is the slide which I am continually putting, and now we know where we are. Okay, so we are studying the Polyneopteran orders. So we have completed the discussion on the Orthoptera. So we are yet to discuss the remaining Polyneopteran orders. Okay, so Blatodea, I'll keep it for next class. So that means, so we are nearing completion of remaining orders. Okay, subdivision Paraneoptera and subdivision Oligoneoptera will be discussed in future classes. So for now, except Blatodea and Orthoptera, which has been already completed, we'll be discussing the remaining Polyneoptera orders. Okay, so we'll take one by one. Order Phasmatodea, which are commonly called stick and leaf insects, also called walking sticks. Etymologically, Phasma means apparition or ghost. Okay, so the name is actually derived from Greek word, referring to their resemblance to vegetation when in fact they are animals. Okay, especially they are camouflaged wherever they are. Say for example, if they are on the leaf, say for example, leaf insects, they exactly look like leaf. Say for example, stick insects usually found on the shrubs, they look like plants. So because of that, they got this name. So usually they are large to very large terrestrial insects found in warmer parts of the world. Especially they are common in tropical parts of the world. So they are attracted considerable attention because of their size. So they are comparatively bigger. You can see here, sometimes they are more than 30 centimeter in length. So they resemble twigs or leaf on which they live, okay, and feed. As a result of that, usually they are camouflaged. They are very, very difficult to be noticed and collected. So important character of Phasmatodea are large apterous or winged phytophagous insects. Okay, they are phytophagous primarily. Frequently elongate, they are longer, cylindrical, okay. So sometimes they are leaf-like. So mouth parts are manipulate. Prothorax is short. Okay, prothorax is small. It's a comparative character which will be compared with any other order. Short. Meson metathorax usually elongate. Okay, so pro is small, whereas meson metathorax is comparatively bigger. Okay, larger. All legs are similar. Okay, they are meant for cursorial, running purpose or walking purpose. Okay, gressorial. So cursorial legs are also called gressorial. So coxae are widely separated. So say for example, in the ventral surface, if you see, coxae are not touching each other from up two legs. Okay, they are widely separated. So there are two families have been recognized under this order Phasmatodea. One is Phyllidae and another is Phasmatidae. So Phyllidae includes leaf insect, Phasmatidae includes stick insects. Okay, so the distinguishing character of these two families are Phyllidae, leaf insects, dorsoventrally flattened and leaf-like. So they are dorsoventrally flattened. Whereas stick insects, they are elongate, body cylindrical. Okay, cylindrical, but they are very elongated and they look like stick-like. Tibiae with small triangular area. So in each leg, tibiae has got small triangular area, which is absent in case of Phasmatidae. Okay, that's how we can distinguish these two families. So important species includes Phyllium Scythae, okay, Phyllium crurifolium, okay, so leaf insects, stick insects, Carassius morosus, okay, so few examples. Try to remember the scientific names as well. So, but coming to biology, the eggs of stick and leaf insects are like seeds or nuts, very colorful and patterned. You can see here, so very different patterned eggs, and the acantonyms. Okay, so without wings, whereas you will find the, in case of adults, you will find both Apteryx or alate forms. Okay, so these are the adult of leaf insects and adults of stick insects. Especially in stick insects, you will find the Apteryx forms as well as the alate form. Okay, so usually four wings are tegmina, whereas the hind wings are membranous. So common to remaining polyneapteran orders. So stick insects are usually parthenogenetic reproduction. So coming to habit and habitat of Osmotodea, they are slow moving herbivores found on tree and shrubs feeding on foliage. So I was telling that they are entirely phytophagous. So found restricted to tropical Asia and Australia. So tropical region they are common. So mostly they are found feeding on acacia and eucalyptus. Usually found in very numerous number, hence they do not damage much. Okay, so hence they are not economically important, as I was telling. So although sexual reproduction occurs in many species, parthenogenetic reproduction is also occurs. So very important, striking character of these Osmotodea, especially stick insects, is that they can regenerate lost legs. Okay, few species like Carassia. Okay, for example, if a predator attacks, okay, especially birds, say for example, they are camouflaged, but birds can still find out these stick insects and leaf insects and can attack and takes part of its legs. Okay, but the last portion is regenerated again. Say for example, if a predator comes and attacks and takes the part of the leg, okay, the last part, the remaining part of the leg actually starts regenerating. So if a nymph happens to be caught by a predator, they escape by autotomizing their legs. Okay, so that they can save their life. Auto amputated legs subsequently regenerate. So that is a very important character which is not found in any other insects, but occurs in these stick insects. Some visuals you can see here. In fact, this order consists of the longest insect group. For example, Pobeticus chaini, which was measuring till recently as they are considered as the longest insects, measuring 56.7 centimeter, found in Malaysia, was considered as the longest insect. But in the year 2016, one more species called Prigonastria chainensis was reported, described from China, which is considered as the longest insect, okay, which measures 62.5 centimeter. Okay, so longest. So these are the leaf insects. In the world, approximately 3,046 species have been described, and from India, 144 species. Okay, so considering that fewer species have been described and do not cause much damage to agriculture, they are considered as minor orders. Okay, so we move on to next order, Mantodea. So they are commonly called mantids, praying mantids. Okay, the etymologically, the word Mantodea is derived from mantis means prophet, eidos means form or type. Okay, apparent resemblance of, okay, many species spend much of their time standing with the forelegs raised, like prayer, awaiting their prey, in fact. Okay, so that's how they keep their legs like this, the four legs. Okay, but they got this name. Okay, Mantodea, prophet, farmer type, eidos means. Okay, mandibulate type, and they are actually predaceous insects. Okay, so they have got hypognathous type of it, and they are predaceous. Get these freely mobile, they can rotate their eggs like this in order to identify the prey, in fact. So four legs are raptorial, okay, predaceous purpose, prehensile type. You can see here the femur and tibia has got a lot of spines. So with the help of that, it actually captures the prey, hold the prey in between femur and tibia and devour. Okay, prothorax greatly lengthened, you can see here. Okay, whereas in case of previous order, Osmotodea we were studying, pronotum is shorter, is a comparative character. You can see, whereas here, pronotum is actually longer, lengthened, movably attached to pterothorax. So pterothorax is nothing but the wing bearing segment of thorax. Okay, mesothorax and metathorax, it is attached. Okay, four wings are tegmina. Okay, like any other polyneoptera, four wings are tegmina, hind wings are membranous. Okay, yeah. Coming to life cycle. So usually the adult female actually deposit the eggs. Whenever it is depositing, it also releases frothy substances, and it attaches those egg mass or egg case into the ticks. So they harden to form the egg case, usually found attached to the ticks like this. So after some time, the nymph starts emerging. You can see here, they are hatching and they are coming out, and then they start dispersing. So they become solitary. Okay, they start moving out and looking for the prey. Okay, so it becomes adults like this. So usually they are solitary, found in all sorts of habitats, from tree canopy to shrubs, on flowers, tree trunks to ground. Okay, so wherever the prey animals are common, there they actually goes and go in search and capture the prey and eat. Mantids are strictly carnivorous. So you will not find the Phytophagous mantids. They are strictly non-vegetarians. Mainly feed on insects, but some other larger species even can feed on frogs, lizards, birds. Okay, so usually they wait for their prey on the flowers or leaf. Usually they get camouflaged. Okay, so waiting for their prey. And whenever another insect comes, it captures and devour. Okay, you can see here it is attacking the lizard. Okay, and even they can attack small birds like hummingbirds. Okay, especially the larger praying mantids like Chinese mantis, Tenodera sinensis, which is more than 4 inch long, can attack hummingbird. Okay, so they are strictly carnivorous. So one very important character of praying mantids is that, okay, female kills males after mating. Okay, so but this character, behavior has been questioned. People have said that it is not true, and many people said that it is actually true. So we will see what is actually happening. It has been said by many researchers that females eat males. Okay, same species eaten, it's called cannibalism. Okay, so it actually happens. The female actually eats the males after copulation, but this behavior is common in caged condition. So when the insects are reared, so this behavior has been noticed, and it is very rare in nature. So people, researchers have not noticed this type of behavior in natural condition. Okay, but few early researchers have said that copulation may be stimulated in the male if the female eats yet. Okay, as the yet releases inhibitory stimuli, as copulation is stimulated by last abdominal ganglia. So of course brain actually stimulates the copulation, but once the head is cut off, there is no brain. So when the last abdominal ganglia in fact is taking care of the copulation stimulation, it will be continuously triggering for copulation, and as a result the female gets advantages, so that all these sperms are actually successfully transferred to the female reproductive tract. So that is the idea behind this argument, in fact. So as it has been said, so this has been noticed only in caged condition, but very rare in nature. Okay, so hope you understand that why this type of phenomenon occurs. So female actually eats the male after mating, the reason being it gets the long time for mating, and also it has been said that it gets the proteinaceous food immediately, so that the male actually sacrifices its life so that its offspring actually get benefited. Okay, few species includes Mantis religiosa, Gangales gangliidus. Okay, approximately 2,425 species have been described worldwide, and in India 174 species. Okay, we move on to next order Notoptera. They are commonly called rock crawlers, eel walkers, gladiators. Okay, maybe few fellow entomologists may start questioning or confusing, what is this order Notoptera? In fact, the order Notoptera is not new. Okay, it was actually proposed as early as 1915 by Crompton, but it was not used till recently. So this name is largely unused since its original conception. Okay, but recent researchers have demonstrated that both Grillo blatodea, that includes rock crawlers, and gladiators, that means Mantoplasmatodea, are actually not separate orders. They are actually belongs to same sister groups. They are actually both these gladiators and rock crawlers are actually very close. Hence, okay, this Notoptera was actually retained and both Grillo blatodea and Mantoplasmatodea are considered family level. Hope you got this point. Okay, actually Notos means back, Tera means wings. Okay, something like back wings. But both these representatives of Notoptera, both rock crawlers and gladiators, okay, are apterous insects. Okay, that means the etymological name is actually a misnomer. Okay, so we don't know why actually this name was actually coined. So regardless of the name, back wings, both Mantoplasmids and Glilloblatids are wingless. So this wingless insect order Notoptera, a group first proposed in the year 1915 by Crompton. The name has been largely unused since its original conception. Okay, so in fact, maybe since last 10, 15 years, we started using NoteOptra again. The name was resurrected and redefined just to give a single order that includes both living and fossil representatives of the lineage. Okay, so that means order NoteOptra consists of two families, Grillo-Blattidae and Mantoplasmatidae. Okay, Mantoplasmatidae. Okay, that means Grillo-Blattodia and Mantoplasmatodia have lost the order status. Okay, they have been downgraded to family level. Okay, so this was actually done by Erillo and Angel. They have combined the two groups into single order called NoteOptra. Okay, hope you got this point. So that means Mantoplasmatodia, okay, was actually considered as the recently described order in the year 2001. Okay, this was described and lot of controversies and arguments, in fact, among scientists that whether it is new or not. Okay, of course, this was considered as new order for a few years, but after this, okay, this research through various morphological and molecular analysis, so these scientists, Erillo and Angel, combined these two into single order called NoteOptra. So that means there is no order called Grillo-Blattodia and Mantoplasmatodia as of now. So we'll study the characters of these two families. Grillo-Blattidae, they are commonly called rock crawlers or ice crawlers. So the apparent meaning is actually because of cricket, like Grillus means crickets, Blattodia means cockroach. They look like crickets and cockroach. So at first look, if you see this angle, for example, it looks like cricket. Whereas this one, if you see this specimen, this looks like cockroach. So that's how this now got the name, Grillo-Blattidae. So these are soft-bodied, apterous insects found under the rocks and in leaf litter in cooler parts of northern hemisphere. So adults' length range from 2 to 3.5 centimeter. Okay, so antenna long, 28 to 50 segmented, very long, filiform. Okay, legs long, cursorial, meant for running purpose. Okay, so abdomen 11 segmented, sarsi long, flexible and many segmented. So these are the few family character of Grillo-Blattidae. So coming to habit and habitat, rock crawlers have no economic importance. The reason being, they live in places that are not inhabited by humans. Okay, so most species are active below freezing, minus 2.3 to 5 degrees centigrade. Okay, so there is no human habitation there. So that means they live in glaciers, ice caves, and usually they die off when they crosses more than 10 degrees Celsius. Okay, so they like very low temperature. That's the thing. They are omnivorous, but feed primarily on diseased arthropods, dying arthropods. When arthropod carcasses are scarce, when they do not get these dying arthropods, their diet relies heavily on plant material. Okay, that's very rare, in fact. The important species is Grillo-Blatta campodiformis. So they are found in, Grillo-Blattids are mainly restricted to northern hemisphere, the cooler part of the world, Japan, Siberia, China, Northwest USA, and Western Canada. Okay, they are found only in those regions. Coming to next family, Mantoplasmatodia, under the order NoteOptera. They are commonly called gladiators or eel walkers. Okay, manto means mantid leg. At first look, they look like mantids, especially if you see the head portion, and they look like stick insect-like. Okay, Plasmatodia. So that's how they got this Mantoplasmatodia, in fact, when they are described, but now that has been downgraded to family level. Described as new order in 2001, but later combined with Grillo-Blattodia, another order, placed under the order NoteOptera. So that means both Mantoplasmatodia and Grillo-Blattodia lost the order status. So coming to important distinguishing character of Mantoplasmatidae, wingless insects superficially resemble certain mantids and stick insects. You can see here. Okay, compound eyes well developed, but lacks ocelli. Antennae long and many segmented. Okay, so few of the visuals found in South Africa, Namibia, and Tanzania. Okay, they look like mantids and stick insects. So they eat many other insects up to their own size. Okay, so in fact, they attack other, carnivores, they attack other insects. Examples, Tyrannophasma gladiator. That's why they're called gladiators, in fact. So previously, when Mantoplasmatodia was described and fewer more species were added, in total 21 species were added under the order Mantoplasmatodia. Okay, any of Mantoplasmatodia lost the order status, and Grillo-Blattodia consisted 34 species. Now, as it is combined, in total 55 species have been described. Okay, so especially if you refer about 10-year old literature, If there is a question called which is the smallest order, we used to tell that Mantoux-Passmatoidea. Okay, anyone know Mantoux-Passmatoidea is not order? So before that, Grillo-Blattodea was considered as the smallest order. So in fact, both of them have lost the order status. That is the thing, in fact. So now, even Notoptera is not the smallest order. Okay, there is no species described from India. Coming to next order Dermoptera, they are called earwigs. So derma means skin, tera means wings. So that means, so skin-like wings, skin-colored now insects. They are elongate, dorsoventrally flattened, winged or apterous insects. You'll find both apterous and winged insects. Prognathus, okay, biting and chewing type of mouthparts. Sarsa is unsegmented, you can see here, okay. Heavily sclerotized like forceps. Okay, so very important character. So other important characters includes four wing modified into very short leathery tegmina. You can see here. So these are the four wings. Okay, they are tegmina. They will not, you will not find any veins there. However, hind wings are semicircular. Okay, they are larger, made up of anal fan. You can see here. Okay, with modified radial venation. You can find here there is a lot of venation. Okay, and almost completely folded beneath tegmina. That means under the four wings. When at rest. So you will not find the hindwings here. But you can see here, these are the exposed, but when they are at rest, all these big hindwings actually closes, folds and placed inside the forewings. In fact, they lose these forceps, that means sarsi, in order to fold those hindwings inside the forewings. That's how they in fact works. Okay, very interesting character. Coming to biology and maternal care, in fact, eggs are laid in batches in the short burrow. Okay, in the ground excavated by the female in the debris. Okay, so it burrows and lays the eggs. Female remain within the eggs and nymphs, found licking the eggs, removing the fungal spores. If the female do not attend to those eggs, okay, fungal spores will develop and they become, they do not hatch. So that's why still, those eggs and early instar nymphs are actually tended by these females. They take care of these, so that maternal care or parental care is actually found in these group of insects. Not many insects have found this type of behavior. So that means they defend the burrow from any other intruder as well because of this well-developed forceps-like sclerotized sarsi. They can even defend any other intruder which try to attack these eggs and early instars. Okay, so there is a sexual dimorphism. You can see these females, which is actually unarmed or toothed, whereas in case of males, okay, we'll find that dentate teeth-like structure. So thereby we can distinguish this female and male. Okay, that means it has got sexual dimorphism. Coming to habit and habitat, the name earwig is derived from an earlier superstition that they enter people ear. Okay, so in fact they do not. So probably some early researchers have noticed this and probably they coined this common name earwigs. They are mainly nocturnal and occur in crevices under the bark of trees, fallen logs, and crawl beneath all kinds of debris on the ground. So probably this is the reason that nocturnal insects, when maybe probably people sleeping, they might have entered. That's why they might have been called earwigs. So, but it is not a natural phenomenon all the time. Their food consists of a wide range of living and dead plant and animal matter. So that means you'll find both phytophagous and predatory species here. So at times, okay, a single species may access metavagus and predatory species. The forceps, that means sarsi, are used for capturing the prey, okay, holding the prey animal and devour. For offense and defense, occasionally, okay, even with the help of these forceps, you can see here, it is trying to attack the other individual, which is trying to enter into its territory and divert its attention. And also for assisting in folding the wing beneath the tegmina, and that means behind the forewings. Okay, common species are Labia minor, Euboreella, Anulipas. Approximately 6,042 species have been described from India, 463 species. Okay, so this is the status. Coming to next order, Plecoptera, they're commonly called stoneflies. Pleco means twisted or plighted. So that means hindwings are folded at rest. Okay, so hindwings are folded, like in case of Dermoptera only. Okay, so tera means wings. Soft-bodied insects of moderate to large-sized. So they are comparatively medium and large-sized insects. Antenna cetaceous, like in case of cockroach. Mouthparts weak and biting type. That means they rarely feed. Hind pairing most species with large anal lobe, this part. Okay, so coming to growth and development. So they, similar to our mayflies, they have got more or less same type of life cycle. Now, Ephemeraptera. You can see our adult actually deposit the eggs in water, aquatic ecosystem. Okay, so they directly deposit the eggs into the water bodies. And the yachad nymphs actually remain under the stones, submerged stones. So that's why they're actually called stone flies. The common name of Lecoptera is actually stone flies. They have earned this name because nymphs or naiads remain under the stones, submerged stones in the aquatic ecosystem. Okay. And the nymphs crawls out and now yachad's adult. Okay, so that's how they complete the life cycle. So young ones, that means naiads actually look like mayfly naiads again. You can see here. What is the difference then? Okay. Stonefly naiads, have sarsi but no caudal filament. Okay, you can see here, two sarsi. But mayfly naiads all the time have got three extensions. Two sarsi, one median caudal filament. Right? So that's how we can distinguish. And also, tarsal claws are two in number, you can see here, like this. Whereas in case of mayfly, you find only one. Okay, only one like this. Of course, there are identical like structure, but there will be only one claw. That's how you can distinguish. Also, we have studied about the filamentous gills, which are found from 1 to 7 abdominal lateral side. But here in this side, they are usually found in the undersurface in case of gills of stonefly. That's how we can distinguish these two different groups. Coming to growth and development, so large number of eggs are laid singly or more often in batches of 100 in aquatic ecosystem. Development is slow, frequently taking more than a year with many molds, up to 33 molds over a period of 3 years. That means in the nymphal stage, it takes more than 3 years, two species. Most stonefly larvae are phytophagous, feeding on lichens, algae, moss, and diatoms. Okay, so that's how they are not economically problematic. Many stoneflies do not feeding as adults. Okay, others feed on lichens, acellular algae, pollen, bark, and rotten wood. Approximately 3,713 species have been described worldwide, and from India, 116. Okay. Coming to next order, Embioptera. Okay, so commonly called embeds, web spinners, and food spinners. So Embia means lively because of the active flight. But okay, so in fact they are not a good agile flyers. Okay, so another misnomer to say, for example. They are distant relatives of stick insects, termites, and earwigs. They are gregarious, found in groups, in fact, living groups, but with no division of labor and no caste system. Okay, apparently they look like termites if you see. You can see a winged termite, but they are small, in fact, but you will not find that caste system at all. Head prognathus, antennae, filiform. Okay, tarsi three segmented. Very important striking character is four tarsi inflated. You can see here, enlarged and having silk glands. So with the help of this inflated first tarsomere, okay, four tarsi, they can able to secrete silk. So again, there will be sexual dimorphism. Females apterous, males are winged or wingless. So that's how they are sexual dimorphic. When winged, they look like winged termites. Okay, important species includes Embio major. Okay, so very important character, outstanding feature of embeds is the ability to spin silk with the four tarsi. You can see here all the time they will find beneath these galleries of silk. Four tarsi consists of silk glands, which are globules arranged like pomegranate seeds. Okay, they secrete the silken threads. They prepare galleries in concealed places like under bark, stones, cracks and crevices or termite mounds. Okay. They live within the galleries except during dispersal. So it is these galleries are like water to fish. Okay, they never come out of these galleries. Only except during dispersal phase, they actually comes out of gallery. Immediately they construct these silken galleries and stay behind. Approximately 457 species have been described and 31 species from India. Okay, so much smaller order in fact. Coming to order Zooroptera. They are commonly called Zooropterans or angel insects. Zoor means pure, Aptera means wingless. Okay, so another misnomer in fact, because so this name, actually this common name might have been used before winged forms were discovered. Okay, that means we'll find both wingless and winged forms under this Zooroptera. Whereas Zoor means purely wingless. Okay, misnomer. Small, less than 4 mm and usually found in the rotting wood, under bark or in piles of old sawdust. Okay, they look like adult winged termite, but smaller with Munliform antennae. Okay, with this Munliform antennae, they look like winged termites. Okay, two segmented tarsi, enlarged hind femur. Hind femur is actually enlarged. Okay, they are wingless forms, lack compound eyes and ocelli, but winged forms have compound eyes and three ocelli. That is the difference between winged and wingless forms. So naturally, winged forms for dispersal probably, so they need this, you know, character of, you know, their good vision. Wings are paddle shaped and shed like in case of ants and termites. Okay, they shed off. Feed on fungal spores and small dead arthropods. Okay, the species is Zorotypa silonicus. So it has got, you know, distributed in Sri Lanka. Approximately 44 species have been described and none from India. Okay, yeah. So I'll end this lecture with a few questions. Other than the praying mantids, in which order females eat males after mating? So I've not told about this character. I told about in case of, you know, praying mantids. In other order also this character is now existing. Find out which order where females eat males after mating. Identify whether it is a male or female earwig. Right? I was telling about sexual dimorphic character of this tarsi. Okay, can you find out which, you know, gender it is? Which order is the smallest among thoughts insecta? I told about this Grillo blattodea, Mantoposmatodea, Mantoposmatodea, and all those things. So try to look, okay, which order is presently has got very fewer number of individual species described. Another question, if you cut off the tarsi of earwigs, okay, how do they look like? Okay, can you compare with other group of insects, whether they look like any other insect groups? Okay, we have not studied it, but no, try to find out. So it becomes easy when you start describing, you know, discussing about those group of insects. So that means, so we were discussing the pollinating orders. We completed the discussion on the Arthropoda in the previous class. So except Blattodea, okay, it includes termites as well. We have completed all the remaining orders of Polyneoptera. Okay, so we'll continue our discussion on the Paraneoptera and Oligoneoptera in the future classes as well. Thank you. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, you can post below or you can email me as well. Thank you. Thank you very much.